Glad to have you guys with us this morning. I had an interesting week. It's been entertaining. Well, entertaining is probably not the best description of it. It's been intriguing. I just give you a glimpse into some of my thinking. Maybe that's the blessing you guys get. You get to see who I am a lot of times from the stage. For me, one of my greatest hearts is to communicate God's word well. The problem is, I in every way want to be Superman, and I'm reminded too often that I'm Clark Kent at best. I want to be at a certain level, and I can remember conversations with a previous pastor here on staff, Pastor John, and I always say to him in sermon preparation, I want to hit a home run every time I prepare a sermon, and he would always say to me, that's a great desire, but understand that doubles and singles are good too, and just realize, and even thinking about that, the reality is, how do you even determine that? How do you evaluate that? But I just recognize the pressure. I recognize the importance of this role. I think about what Jesus's brother James said. He said, "Not many of you should become teachers, my fellow believers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly." So I recognize that this role and this responsibility is heavy and it's great. And I come off of a week like, maybe some of you last week are like, it was okay. It was subpar, but, serviceable. I came off of last week's sermon just feeling like God had really stirred in my heart. I knew exactly what I wanted to say. I knew the content. I knew where I wanted to go. I knew how it would flow. I felt like if somebody stole my notes, it wouldn't matter. I would know exactly what I wanted to say, and I could do it passionately. And so the problem with those moments is I go into preparation the next week with this desire of replicating that. And this pressure starts to build. And in the midst of the pressure, in a short turnaround week, I decided on, I'm in this big protein diet right now, and I decided I made myself some steak early in the morning. I was going to have that at 11. I even made a beef roast for the family. I put that in a crock pot so my wife didn't have to worry about dinner, and I was going to have that later that evening. So I sat down at 11 at my desk to start eating some of my steak. I got three bites in, and it lodged in my esophagus. Now, I could breathe, so don't freak out. Apparently, Pete was planning my funeral when he heard about this, in a loving way. No, he wasn't like, so glad he's gone. But it lodged in my esophagus, and I've had something like that happen before where I could drink and the water would just sort of turn in there and come back out. But eventually I could push it down, and I tried everything all day long. I tried water, I tried seltzer water, I tried Diet Coke, I tried Coke. I even ate oil, like butter, a piece of butter, like anything to get that to go, and I could not get it. Baking soda and water. I tried everything the internet told me to try. I was even looking in my house for like, where are some tubes I could shove down my throat to try to fix this issue? And I couldn't all day long from 11 a.m. And about 7:30 p.m. And I had worked, I could breathe. I worked out beforehand. I went home, I worked out. I just couldn't drink anything. Couldn't drink or eat. So I called my wife or texted my wife and said, I think you need to take me to the emergency room. So we went to the emergency room, and there I was at 9 o'clock, and at 1 in the morning, they took me into the operating room, and I had to go under anesthesia, and they had to put a scope down and push whatever was in there down, and about 2 a.m., I came out of anesthesia, very loopy. Apparently, I'm a crier anesthesia guy, and I mean like full-on weeping, like every emotion I've ever suppressed in my life was just pouring out of me. They kept asking me, are you hurt? I'm like, no, my throat's sore. I don't know why I'm crying. Like, just weeping. And I knew everything that I was saying, even though I felt, it's like truth serum. Like, I felt like I had to say it, no matter what. And they said, well, we're going to go get your wife. And I said, oh, I just don't want to say anything stupid. And the nurse, without skipping a beat, says, I'm pretty sure men just do that anyway. Like, that was pretty funny. So here I am, 2 in the morning, I'm wrestling through this situation and realizing I can't even do the most basic of human things, which is swallow. And I want to be Superman. And I'm reminded that I can do nothing apart from Jesus Christ. Nothing. Throughout the day, I'll be honest with you, I was frustrated. Kept praying to God, God, help this go down. God, fix this. This not ask. It's not a big request, God, do something about this, and became frustrated that he didn't. And I was reminded as we consider the final week of Jesus Christ, that Jesus, on the night before his crucifixion, knew what it felt like to ask the Father to change his mind and to hear the Father gently but firmly say, no. And with you and me in his mind and heart, Jesus would continue down a path that would lead to a cross, that would lead to his resurrection, so that you and I could have life. As we look at the last week of Jesus and consider the fact that we so desperately need him, what I was struck by is that very reality that Jesus had you and me in mind. In fact, Jesus prayed for you. In his final week, before the cross, and all of the things he chose to do, the things that mattered so much to him, the things that were so important for him to say and do, one of the things he chose to do in that final week was to pray for you specifically. Listen to the prayer. Jesus says, I pray not only for these, speaking of the 11, but also for those who believe in me through their word. Now, I recognize maybe some of you, you have stories in your life of grandparents or great-grandparents who prayed for you or prayed for your future spouse, and that's a beautiful thing. But what's happening here, it's not Jesus praying for some theoretical person. He prayed for you specifically, all those who would believe in me, and he knew you personally when he prayed. I want you to catch that. I don't want us to breeze past that. There's so much weight in just this phrase. Jesus says, I pray for those who would believe in their word. So he knows that in moments, in hours, these 11 disciples are going to abandon him and walk away, but he also knows that they will be restored. They will preach his gospel, and that through the gospel, others will come to believe. Can I tell you this morning, he knows that for you too. He knows your mistakes and your failures and your sins, but he also knows the restoration that can come through him and the potential ministry that he could utilize you for. I think what also it indicates is that he prayed for you and I specifically just hours before his death. And I want you to personalize that. Jesus prayed for Phil. Hours before his death, with the literal weight of the world on his shoulders, he prayed for you. It's significant. When I'm stuck wondering if God really cares, in the final week of the cross, Jesus indicates in his prayer that he does. In fact, Peter would write this, cast your cares upon him, because he cares for you. Again, personalize it. These are realities that we have a hard time accepting. That the Creator of all things would care about me specifically. I'm reminded of the words of Hudson Taylor, it is time for us to stop putting asking in front of accepting. It's time for us to begin accepting the reality of what God has declared to be true. He prayed for you because he cares for you. So what did he pray for? Well, as we look at the text, one of the things we'll find is he prayed for us to be united. Jesus goes on and says, may they all be one, as you, Father, are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe you sent me. I have given them the glory you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. I am in them, and you are in me, so that they may be made completely one, that the world may know you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. When Jesus prayed for you and he prayed for me, he prayed that we would be united, that we would be united in who Jesus is and united in him as he's united in the Father. He prayed earlier, in speaking about the 11 specifically, he says, Holy Father, protect them by your name that you have given me so that they may be one as we are one. One of his concerns is that we would be united. Now, I want to share this because I'm fearful of what the sort of umbrella of unity in the church across the nation and the Western world, what it has presented or pushed. Notice that Jesus says, I pray that you would be united in me, that those who believe in me would be united. What we have created is a unity that is bound in love, not Jesus Christ. Love is the expression of the bond in Jesus Christ, not the bond itself. What we've created in the Western church is a unity that allows for people to deny Jesus Christ, yet still be united in love for one another. That's not what he prays. It's not a unity in love alone, devoid of him. It's unity in him which expresses itself in love. In fact, John, who recorded this prayer for us, didn't interpret it that way. He would write in his first letter to the churches, he would write, test the spirits to see if they are from God. Specifically, test to see what they say about the person of Jesus Christ. He would go on in a second letter, writing, to a house church. And he writes this, anyone who runs ahead and does not continue in the teaching of Christ does not have God. Catch that. So somebody who says, well, I'm cool with God, I just don't buy the whole Jesus thing. Anybody who runs ahead and does not continue in the teaching of Christ does not have God, John writes. Whoever continues in the teaching has both the Father and the Son because they are united, they are one. If anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, do not take them into your house or welcome them. Anyone who welcomes them shares in their wickedness. Sounds the opposite of what our culture would deem unity. But the unity that Christ is speaking of is a unity that's founded on him. And I fear that there are churches and pastors whom the world loves because they speak what the world is comfortable with. Yet Jesus said this in his prayer, I have given them your word. The world hated them because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I am not praying that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. While our expression of unity in Christ is an expression of love, love may not be what we receive. Jesus says they hated them because they hate him. Maybe you're here this morning and you're curious and you're just checking things out. I want you to consider for a moment why the world seems to hate Jesus so much. I just saw it yesterday. Maybe you're not a big comic book fan. But the X-Men just put out a comic book or a comic story in which Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of the Living God, is one of the first mutants. Why is that never Muhammad or Buddha? Because the world hates Jesus. Because the world is opposed to him. Jesus' call for us is not a unity that's in love alone, devoid of him. It's a call for unity in him which expresses itself in love. Here's the unity. I think Paul describes it very well in Ephesians chapter 2. I want to read this for you. Paul says, so then remember that at one time you were Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcised by those called the circumcised, which is done in the flesh by human hands. At that time, you were without Christ, excluded from the citizenship of Israel and foreigners to the covenants of promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, who made both groups one and tore down the dividing wall of hostility. In his flesh, he made of no effect the law consisting of commands and expressed in regulations, so that he might create in himself one new man from the two, resulting in peace. He's speaking of unity. He did this so that he might reconcile both to God in one body through the cross by which he put the hostility to death. He came and proclaimed the good news of peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole building being put together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him, you are also being built together for God's dwelling in the Spirit. That's the unity that we hold. A unity in Jesus Christ, where the dividing lines of Jew and Gentile have been destroyed, and now we are one in him, just as he and his Father are one. He also prayed that we would receive his glory or share in his glory. He says, Father, I want those you have given me to be where I am so that they will see my glory, which you have given me because you loved me before the world's foundation. He prayed earlier, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you. I have glorified you on the earth by completing the work you gave me to do. Now, Father, glorify me in your presence with that glory I had with you before the world existed. If there is a stronger declaration of the deity of Jesus Christ, I don't know where it is. The glory that I had with you, Father, before the foundation of the world was established. Jesus shared in that glory. He set aside that glory to become a man, glorified the Father by dying as a man for our sin, raising from the dead to give us new life and restoration, and then ascended into the heavens and placed at that seat of glory once again. And Jesus says, I wish that they would share in my glory. That those who believe in me would share in my glory. That word glory could be defined as a radiance or a reflection. Jesus said throughout this prayer, he says, Righteous Father, the world has not known you. However, I have known you, and they have known you sent me. He is the very reflection of the Father. If we have seen Jesus, we have seen the Father. And the opposite is true. Often what we do is we say, well, we see God in the Gospels. We also see Jesus in the Old Testament. Because the two are one. So if I see the Father, I see the Son. If I see the Son, I see the Father. He is the very reflection or radiance of the glory of God. And what he's asking for is that you and I would become that same reflection and radiance. Jesus, the physical representation here on earth, established the church. The church is also biblically called the body of Christ. We become the new physical representation of God on earth. We reflect God. We radiate God. We radiate his glory. That's what Jesus prays for. He prays that we would complete the work that he's called us to, just as he's completed the work that the Father has called him to. I had an interaction with a young man the other day. A couple weeks back, we went out to lunch. He's 19. He's off at college. It was so intriguing because I know his father fairly well, and as I'm listening to him and watching him, I can see his father's mannerisms in his hand gestures, in his vocal inflection, and probably for him, probably like most of us guys, if you tell him you're like your father, that just stings for whatever reason. We're opposed to that for whatever reason. But he's so much like his father. I think that's what Jesus is praying here, that we would reflect our father. We would be an expression of him. He goes on and prays that we might be loved. Even more than being an expression of love, he prays that we would have the experience of love. Listen to his prayer. He says, I am in them and you are in me, so that they may be made completely one, that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. He goes on and says, I made your name known to them and will continue to make it known so that the love you have loved me with may be in them and I may be in them. Think about that. Through belief in Jesus Christ, the same love that the Father has for his only begotten Son, he has for you. Even more than expression of love, Jesus is praying that you and I would experience the love of the Father. His prayer in the final week was that you would know the Father's love. You would experience the Father's love. It was a few years ago now, my son was inviting a couple kids from the neighborhood into the house, and they were playing video games and hanging out, and I thought it was great. It was awesome that he was having that kind of heart for kids in the community. Then one morning, they were over, it was a Saturday, I think it was, they were over, he comes downstairs, they had left, he comes downstairs, and he said, "Somebody stole my money." And he had worked really hard. I think he had done some jobs from a friend of mine. He was working. He saved up like $50, and they stole all of his money. Stole. Now, he was upset. Can I tell you I was more upset? What you did to my son, you did to me. And the boys came back later, knocked on the door, and I said, "I'm glad you guys returned. Because you owe my son some money. Let's have a conversation." And the one boy eventually fessed up to it, and we worked through it. And I'll tell you, I love those boys, and I want what God wants for them, but there is a special love that I have for my own children. God loves you the same way he loves his only begotten son. That's what Jesus prays you would know and would experience. What he reveals, and here's my bottom line, he has so that you might. What do I mean by that? Jesus has done what he did, what he chose to do, so that you might be and might experience everything that God has called you to experience. Notice what he prays. Throughout his prayer, he says, "I have glorified you on the earth by completing the work you gave me to do." He prays, "I have revealed your name to the people you gave me from the world. I have given them the words you gave me. I have given them your word. I also have sent them into the world. I have given them the glory you have given me." Jesus, throughout this prayer, just declares over and over, "I have so that they might. I have united them with the Father so they might be united with one another. I have given them glory so that they might glorify the Father. I have loved them so that they might love." You can go on and on with the list. "I have forgiven them so that they might forgive. I have shown mercy so that they might show mercy. I have been generous so that they might be generous." He declares to us in his prayer, "I've done what God is the Father has called me to do so that they might go be and do what he has called them to be and do." Repeatedly, he expresses that he did what he did so that we could. And the goal is evangelism. I don't know if you noticed, and we've been through a lot of text here, but over and over again he says, "so that the world may know that you sent me." And I was wrestling through that as I'm prepping. Why was it so important for the world to know that God sent his son? Because that's the gospel. That's the greatest news in history. It's the very expression of God's love that he would send his son to bear the penalty of our sins so that we might have new life. In fact, John would write about this in 1 John. "This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." Jesus said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you, since you gave him authority over all flesh, so that he may give eternal life to everyone you have given him. This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and the one you have sent, Jesus Christ." Notice that Jesus doesn't speak about eternal life in terms of duration. He speaks of eternal life in terms of relationship. This is eternal life, that we would know the one and only true God and know the Son that he sent. Jesus' prayer is that you would experience what he has done so that you might be an expression of what he has done. He has, so that you and I might. So let's go be. Let's put aside the asking and begin accepting what is true in Jesus Christ and begin living who he's called us to be because of what he has done. Let's pray. Lord, I recognize without you, I have nothing, I can do nothing, I can be nothing. All good things come from the Father above. The whole earth is the Lord's and everything in it, and that includes me. And Lord, perhaps there's somebody here this morning who's walked in the room or they're listening at home and they have never considered that you cared for them. Not a theoretical person, them. That you love them. Father, that you sent your Son for them as an expression of that love so that they would know that you could love them the same way you loved him through belief in Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that they would today receive Jesus. We cannot reject the Son and accept the Father. You are one just as you've called us to be one. Father, I pray that they would know this morning that if they have believed in you, 2,000 years ago, you prayed for them. You prayed that they would be united, that they would experience your glory, that they would also experience your love so that they could know your joy. Joy that surpasses what we see in our world. Joy that surpasses circumstances and stuff and materialism. Joy that is founded on a relationship with life itself, the God of the universe. But I ask that this morning would be the day they receive the greatest news ever told. And for those of us who have received, Father, I pray that because of what your Son has done, we might be. That we would go from here being an expression of your love, an expression of your glory, an expression of your unity, founded in the person of Jesus Christ, who died and gave himself for us. I pray this in his name. Amen.